Everyone get the PowerPoint slide ready so I can start the lecture.
Sorry, so which slide? Yes.
Not very clear.
So your voice not very not clear.
Your voice, yes.
Okay, let me switch.
Your voice not clear, sir. The right. Voice.
I'm using the Mac now.
Now better.
Okay. Yes.
That's clear. Why I use Mac. I don't use other. Alright. Now. Okay. This one JBL Apple product. Right. Okay, now can we start the lecture?
Yes.
Yes. Right.
Okay. Yes. For the law of thought, okay, law of thought. This is what we're going to cover. Okay. In this law of thought. What is law of thought? Okay, first we're going to talk what is law of thought. Then we're going to talk about negligence. Okay, negligence. And lastly, which is more important to you guys, the professional advice. Meaning, what are the risks? Okay, what are the risks of negligence that you can do, okay, that you might be exposed to in your line of work? Okay, it can be anything. Okay, it can be a lawyer, it can be a doctor, can be an engineer, can be a teacher, okay, can be anyone. All right. Okay, now okay, what is the law of thought? What's law of thought? Okay, law of thought is the is a civil wrong. Okay. Thought is from the French word, means literally mean wrong. Okay, now, why I teach or why I cover law of thought right after law of contract? Because you need to distinguish between distinguish between contract and thought. Because under the law of contract, when you wanted to establish whether that person is liable to you under the law of contract, you must be able to show that that person is under actual relationship with you. Okay, meaning before you can establish a duty under the law of contract, you must be able to show that the person is under a contractual relationship with you. But what happened if there is no contractual relationship? Meaning to say that person is not under contract with you. That person do not have any relationship with you. So how do you prove liability? How do you prove duty? How do you prove that the person is liable to you? All right. This is where the law of thoughts come into the picture. Because under the law of thought, you do not need to prove that the person is under a contractual relationship with you. You only to need to prove that the person is under the duty of care. Okay, duty of care. So what is this duty of care? We're going to talk about duty of care later, okay, in this lecture. So for example, okay, for example, all of you attending this lecture, okay, MBA, corporate law, MBA, and I did not come for the whole semester. Okay, I did not come for the whole semester. Every time there's classes, I just say, hey, look, I can't come for the class, so I need to cancel. Okay, I need to cancel, you know that. Excuse me. So for the whole semester, I didn't come for the class. And because of that, at the end of the semester, when you need to take your final exam, right? Because of you have not, I have not attended any of my classes. I did not teach you anything. So you can't answer your final exam question. That's normal. That's common sense. Because you did not learn anything. I did not teach you anything. I did not give you any instruction. Then when it comes to the final exam, of course you can't answer the question. So you fail your corporate law exam, for example, because of me. So that, okay, because of you failing the exam, you need to register for the exam for corporate law for the next semester. And this costs you some more money, registration fee and all that, and it costs you time, okay, because you need to extend your courses because of the corporate law subject. So the time that you need to reinvest, the time that you need to take the corporate law again, the extra fees that you need to pay for taking corporate law again is your damage. It's your loss, okay, your loss, your damage. So that my failure to do my duty as a lecturer, that's what we call negligence. Okay, negligence, that's what we call negligence. Right? So that is the law of thought. Meaning, law of thought means wrong, a civil wrong. Basically, every one of us, we have what we call this civil duty towards another. So this civil duty is under the law, under the common law, meaning there's no statute which regulates the law. It's a common law. So I have a duty of care towards you. Okay, I have a duty of care towards you, and you have a duty of care towards another person. So each one of us have a duty of care not to damage, not to injure another person. All right? So that is what we call law of thought. Okay, basically that is the definition of law of thought. All right. Any question at this moment? Do you understand the concept? Ahmad Luqman Hakim. Ahmad Luqman Hakim. Where are you, Ahmad Luqman Hakim? Ahmad Luqman Hakim. Ahmad Luqman Hakim, where are you?
I think it's volume still.
Oh, the volume.
It's volume.
Hello, sir.
Ahmad Luqman Hakim, are you there?
Yeah, I'm here.
All right. So, Ahmad Luqman Hakim, do you have any question about the concept of law of thought?
Sorry, sir.
Do you have any question? Do you need any more clarification on the concept of duty of care?
Karino, sir.
Karino. All right. You're clear. All right. So law of thought is quite simple. Okay, it's quite straightforward. It's quite simple, quite straightforward, but yet it is so interesting because especially in America, OK, Okay, especially in America, you have this class action. Okay, class action. You may have heard about those who suffered from cancer. Okay, those who have suffered from cancer because they are they are heavily smokers. Okay, they smoke a lot, and they because of the smoking. Okay, for a number of years, they contracted cancer, and they sued the tobacco company. They have a class action, meaning, let's say a group of smokers who are suffering from cancer, lung cancer, and all that. They initiated a class action against tobacco companies for negligence. Okay, for negligence. So that is negligence. Okay, that is the classic case of negligence. And maybe some of you may be old enough to watch this movie by Erin Brockovich. Have you heard about the movie Erin Brockovich? Are you guys old enough to watch that movie?
I've heard the name.
Okay, you heard the name. Okay, you guys go and Google. Perhaps there is in Netflix, I'm not sure, or in YouTube. Erin Brockovich. That is a classic case of negligence in the law of negligence in America. Okay, what happened in Erin Brockovich is the water, okay, the water in certain areas was polluted by this company, and because of that pollution caused by this company, so the people in that area suffering from cancer, okay, from cancer. So this Erin Brockovich, she works with this legal firm, and she collected all these people, okay, and they initiated against this company. So they won. Okay, they won. This movie is based on true event. Okay, based on true event. So they won actually against that company who polluted the water in that area. Okay, they managed to get damages. The company need to pay them. Need to pay damages. Need to pay reparation against these people. Alright. So it sounds familiar. I think you may have heard about around last month when this illegal factory polluting the water resources in Klang Valley, for example. All right, that's negligence. Okay, that's negligence. However, in Malaysia, we do not have class action. Okay, because of certain courts procedure, so class action in Malaysia is not that rampant. Class action in Malaysia is not something which is somehow it is. Never happened in Malaysia because of the local standard issue, but that's another issue. Okay, that's another issue. It just that I just wanted to show to you that this is a various example of a law of thought in action. Okay, all right. Now, if you go to the next slide, okay, you go to the next slide. The question is, what is negligence? Because just now I'm talking about negligence, duty of care, and all that. Okay, so what is negligence? Okay, what is negligence? Basically, it's the defendant, meaning those who are the guilty party, owe you the duty of care. Okay, somebody owe you a duty of care, and that person breached that duty of care. And because of the breach, okay, because of the breach, it resulted in damage, meaning you suffer losses. Okay, and then you suffer losses. And that damage, okay, that loss that you suffered must be foreseeable. Okay, that is basically negligence and breach of legal duty of care. For example, okay, for example, you go to a restaurant. OK, Okay, you go to a restaurant. I think I give you the example last week when I talk about you go to the restaurant, you eat a something for dinner, then somehow that food is poisonous, or then you suffered diarrhea, you suffered from food poisoning and it caused you diarrhea and all that. So you suffer losses. You need to go to the hospital, you need to pay for the medication, you need to be warded, and you have loss of income. All right, so that's the meaning of the restaurant owner owes you a duty of care by serving you poisonous food. They have breached the duty of care, and because of that action, they have breached they have caused you damage, it caused you loss, and the loss must be foreseeable. Okay, it need to be directly related to that breach of duty of care. Okay,
doctor.
Yes.
May I know the name of the cat?
The name of the
cat besides you.
Oh, the cat. Oh, this one. Hmm. Oh, this one, Leo. Leo. He's like a 5 years old. A 5 year old cat. Named after great Russian novelist Leo Tolstoy. All right. So when I told all my friends my cat named Leo, is it Leo DiCaprio? Nothing to do with Leo DiCaprio. I named my cat based on the great Russian novelist called Leo Tolstoy. All right. Have you heard about Leo Tolstoy before?
No.
Have you heard about War and Peace? You have not read the novel War and Peace by Leo Tolstoy.
Yeah, I know.
War and Peace is about he wrote that story. War and Peace. The background story was like during the Caesar's era in Russia. Okay, whereby Russia is still under the Caesar. And during that time, they have war with the French, the Napoleon. Okay, that one, the war between the French and the Russian. And the story about War and Peace is within that era. Okay, and the name of the novelist who wrote that novel is Leo Tolstoy. All right. You guys are not too literature, is it?
No.
Okay, new generation. Okay, yeah, I would understand. But I think there's a movie, but it's an old movie. They converted the novel to movie. But again, it's very old movie.
Yeah.
Right. All right. Okay. Any question beside my cat? I got five cats. Right. One named Steve and named after Steve Jobs, another one Elon, named after Elon Musk, but that Elon died already, so I left with five.
How about, for example, if you recall a few months ago, where a concrete slab fell on a car,
yeah,
in MR2. So for that sort of situation, does it fall under negligence or is it something else?
Yes. Yep, it's negligence because it is a negligent cases, but usually when they go to court, it is settled between insurance company. Because I would be confident that the construction company have an insurance to cover such losses. So usually those insurance company will settle on behalf of the construction companies. But if the victim, okay, I think they survive he or she survived that accident. If she wanted to sue under negligence, yes, he can. He or she can do that under the law of negligence. All right. Again, in Malaysia, the law of negligence is not that very developed. Okay, usually negligence cases are in an accident cases, motor vehicle accident cases, and usually it is more of the insurance company settling between the victim and the plaintiff. Okay. Right, you never see $1 million or $1 billion damages given to the victim. All right, it's always very minimum.
So okay.
Yes.
How about if the smokers can we sue? No, I mean, like, can they sue the tobacco companies?
Yeah, it's in America we can, but in Malaysia, it never done before. Okay, never. There's no smokers suffering from cancer in Malaysia had tried before.
But doctor, the package. What kind of packaging they are doing, the inside and outside a label they are putting that no harm occurs, harm will be occurs if you smoke. So company already told that it's dangerous for you, but again you take it, so it's not the company's fault.
That's the exact argument given by the American tobacco companies. Then there's a class action against them in America, in the US. Basically, the argument against the suit or against the plaintiff was that the plaintiff who are chain smokers, they're fully aware about the risks. There's a lot of medical report talking about the harm of smoking. All right. So when the plaintiff smoke, they're fully aware of the risk. But the argument by the plaintiff was that they can't stop because of the nicotine, because it's addictive, and they show that the content of the nicotine in a cigarette, the tobacco company aware of this. Okay, they're aware about the nicotine, the percentage of nicotine in a cigarette, and they know that it is addictive. And yet, they allow for the selling of the tobacco, all right, for the cigarette. So that is the argument of the plaintiff, the smokers, all right, because they can't stop because of the addiction. I'm sure those who are smokers, they can attest to that. They can't stop. For us, for me, it's I'm not a smoker, so I don't know, but I got a lot of friends who are smokers. They say that they can't stop. Okay, although they wanted to stop because of they're having a small children. They have because of their wife, you know, that because of their own health, but they can't stop because it's so addictive. Okay, so addictive, so they can't stop.
Yeah,
it takes. Yeah. Nah, that's Steve.
Okay.
Any other question? Nope. All right. Okay. Then let's look at the next slide. Okay, the next slide. Duty of care. Okay, duty of care. Now, what do we mean by duty of care? Okay, the duty of care is the duty to take reasonable care not to cause foreseeable harm to others. Okay, just now, like the construction companies, they need to take all the reasonable measures, okay, to make sure that the slab doesn't fall to the person underneath the project. Meaning they need to make sure that they put in maybe safety nets, for example, okay, or make sure that the slab is properly fastened to whatever, okay, to the concrete. Maybe they need to put in a safety net underneath the project, or they need to put in the some signs, okay, some signs saying that, okay, dangerous, okay, danger, okay, it is a construction area, do not enter, for example. So basically, duty of care means you need to take all the reasonable measures. Okay, if you fail to take all these reasonable measures, then you know that this will cause harm to others. Okay, foreseeable harm. You know that if you don't do this, this will happen. Okay, so that is the meaning of duty of care. All right, but then, yes, any question? No, all right. So the concept of duty of care, it started with this case, Donahue against Stevenson. Remember when I talk, when I tell you about law of contract, right? Okay.
Yes.
Before Donahue against Stevenson, before you can establish a duty, okay, before you can establish someone is liable to you, you need to have a contractual relationship. Okay, up until this Donahue against Stevenson. Donahue against Stevenson is the first case that says that you do not have to establish a contractual relationship. Okay, so what happened in Donahue against Stevenson in 1932? So basically, Mrs. Donahue, she went to a cafe with a friend. Right, and then the friend bought her a bottle of ginger beer. Meaning, it's not Mr. Donahue who bought the bottle of ginger beer, but her friend. Okay, her friend bought a bottle of ginger beer, and however, that ginger bought the ginger beer bottle is opaque. It means it's a glass bottle, but it's opaque. You know what's opaque, right? So it's a glass bottle which is opaque means it is somehow translucent, but somehow you can't see much inside. Okay, it's a glass, but it's an opaque glass. So they go for a drink, and they drink the ginger beer, and her friend he poured the rest of the whatever contained in the opaque bottle to Miss Donahue. Okay, when she poured the bottle, she poured the ginger beer. Okay, he emptied the bottle. All right, like this. Okay, and then somehow a decomposed meal pop up from the bottle. And Mrs. Donahue saw this. Okay, Mrs. Donahue saw the decomposed nail. Okay, in the bottle. Then the sight. Okay, she found this sight so upsetting, and because of that, she suffered a physical illness, what we call nervous shock. Why? Because she saw a decomposed nail pop up from that opaque ginger beer bottle. Seeing that decomposed nail, okay, coming up from the bottle is so upsetting. She felt ill. Okay, she felt ill. What we call nervous shock. She sued the manufacturer. Okay, sued the manufacturer, but there is a problem, because up until this case, Donahue against Stevenson. Before you can sue for damages, you need to prove contractual relationship. The problem here, the one who bought the ginger beer is not Mrs. Donahue, but her friend. Okay, so it is her friend who has a contractual relationship with the owner of the ginger beer. All right, or with the manufacturer of the ginger beer. So there is a problem here. Okay. How can Mrs. Donahue claim from the manufacturer when she do not have any contractual relationship with the manufacturer? Okay, so that is the problem. So the court in this case, they think that, okay, look, we need to deliver justice. Okay, the manufacturer, based on the testimony of the witnesses, okay, clearly shows that the factory, okay, of the manufacturer, the condition of the factory is so dirty. Okay, so dirty. There are evidence of traces of the snail mucus all over the factory. So one of the snail might got into one of the bottle. Okay, so there's the condition of the factory is so dirty, it's not well kept. So the court in this case, they think that yes, they need to somehow punish. They need to make this manufacturer liable. But the problem is, there is no contractual relationship between Mrs. Donahue and the manufacturer. So how do they go around this legal obstacle? So they come up with the duty of care. Okay, they come up with duty of care. Okay, if you look at the next slide, okay, they come up with the neighborhood principle. Okay, neighborhood principle. Okay, this principle was taken from the Bible. The Bible says that you must love your neighbor. So the court says that you have a duty of care and you must not injure your neighbor. Okay, so the question is to the court, my lord, who is my neighbor? Okay, because when the court speak the principle, the Bible principle, saying that you must love your neighbor, you must not hurt your neighbor, then the question is to the lawyers, who is my neighbor? Okay, who is my neighbor that I must not injure, which I must not damage, which I must not harm them. So the court says that neighbor means any person who are directly affected by my act that I ought reasonably have them in contemplation. Meaning to say, my neighbor is anyone who is directly affected by my action or omission. Okay, you guys, does it make sense to you guys? Meaning like my
Doctor,
first, yes.
So in that case, we are neighbor. We are your neighbor.
Yeah. Like my first example just now, right? When I did not come to any of my class for the whole semester. So who is the one who going to be directly affected by my action or my omission? It's you guys, correct?
Yeah.
Right, you guys will be affected. So I must know that if I do not come to class, you guys will be directly affected. Correct? So because of my omission, or why when I did not come to the class, then I must know that you guys going to fail this subject. All right, so that's the basically Donahue against Stevenson. All right, so for example now, if someone who knows that he's already infected with dangerous disease, but then this person goes around, okay, to a crowded places, then you know that there will be risks. Okay, there will be risks that going to disseminate the disease. Okay, you may say that this person has breached the duty of care. Okay, does it make sense?
Yes,
it's quite easy, right?
Yeah,
common sense, right? Yeah, law is basically common sense, right? Law which doesn't make sense is not a good law. Okay, any question or can I proceed?
Yes, you can proceed.
Right,
we'll proceed.
Yeah, we're going to, there's only like 16 pages, 16 slides. Okay, I think we can finish early, not last week.
Okay.
Like this, no question, we can We can finish early. All right, now, breach of duty. Okay, breach of duty. So now, to prove that you had breached the duty, okay, you must prove that the conduct of the defendant fell below the standard set by the law. Okay, now, that's another question. Just now, the question is, who is my neighbor? But now, the question is, what is the standard? Okay, because just now I said that you need to take considerable care to prevent harm to your neighbor. But then, how much do you need to do? Okay, how much, what is the standard that you need to do? How far that you must go to make sure that no harm done to another? So the court says that you must take the reasonable man test. Okay, now, then the question is, what is the meaning of reasonable man test? Okay, because some people may not be reasonable. Okay, what is reasonable to me may not be reasonable to you. Correct?
Yep.
Okay, so in the case of Blythe, again, Birmingham Waterworks, yeah, in 1856, 11, volume 11, Exchequer, page 781. He says that negligence is the omission to do something that reasonable man guided upon those consideration which ordinary regulate the conduct of human affairs would do or doing something which a prudent and reasonable man would not do. Quite a mouthful, right? Very old English sentence, very harsh. But what does it mean? What does it mean, say that the omission to do something that a reasonable man guided upon those questions which ordinarily regulate the conduct of human affairs would do or doing something which prudent and reasonable man would not do? What does it mean? Meaning to say, or anyone want to try? It's a very archaic English, and very old English sentence. Yeah, 1856 English. All right, now, basically, it's trying to say that you need to ask whether a reasonable man would do the same or would not do the same. For example, if you wanted to test, okay, you want to test my action, not coming to the class, teaching you for the whole semester. Then you look at another lecturer. Would a reasonable lecturer, okay, would a reasonable lecturer will skip the class for the whole semester? Is that a reasonable lecturer? In your opinion? No, right?
No.
Because if you ask 10 out of 10, okay, 10 out of 10 lecturers, that lecturer will say that it is not reasonable to skip classes for the whole semester. Correct?
Yes.
Yeah, that's the meaning of reasonable man. Meaning you ask the peers. Okay, I'll give you another example. Let's say you wanted to test a doctor, okay, whether this doctor is reasonable or not. Now, let's say this doctor conducted a surgery and he or she accidentally left a scissor inside the body of that person, of that patient. It happened, right? I think you heard the news. It happened. So now we wanted to test whether this doctor is reasonable or not. Okay, whether this doctor is reasonable or not. So what you do is, okay, hold on, yeah, let me. Okay, right. Okay, what you need to do is you need to get another surgeon, okay, another surgeon, or a group of surgeon. Then you ask this group of surgeon, is it reasonable for a surgeon to leave a scissor inside the body of the patient? Definitely the answer is not reasonable. Correct? So whenever you wanted to test someone whether that person is negligence, okay, you need to ask their peers. Meaning if you wanted to test whether the doctor is reasonable or not, then you ask another doctor. If you need to test whether that lecturer is reasonable or not, then you need to ask another lecturers, the peers. Okay, you need to compare orange and orange, apple and apple. You wanted to, for example, in the case of that construction companies, then you need to look at the practice of another construction companies as well. Okay, so that is what we mean by the standard of reasonable man test. Got it?
Yes.
Cool. All right.
That's reasonable enough.
Yeah, very reasonable enough, right? It's very easy, right? Straightforward. That's why in court, sometimes you watch movie, right? You watch movie and you saw the lawyers, the prosecution or the defense, they call the expert witness to give testimony or to give evidence in court. So this is the reason why, because they wanted to show that whether the conduct of the defendant, is it reasonable or not, based on the expert opinion. All right? Okay. Now, next slide. Okay, next slide. You need to look at the causation. What caused the harm? What harm? So the plaintiff, okay, the plaintiff must show that the harm would not have occurred not for the negligence of the defendant. Okay, meaning to say you need to show that it is the defendant who caused you the harm. But you need to remember that the harm must not be too remote. Meaning to say that it must be direct. It cannot be something like indirect or something which is unforeseeable. Okay, the harm must be direct. The cause must be direct. And you need to show that that harm or that damage or that injury are caused by the defendant. And not because of the defendant, you will not suffer the harm. You will not suffer the damage. You will not suffer the injury. Is it straightforward enough for you guys?
No.
Cool?
Cool.
All right.
Doctor, if that's...
Yes. Who's talking there?
Ain,
where are you, Ain? Can I see you?
I'm driving right now.
Oh, okay, school, okay. You be careful, yeah? Careful, yeah. Don't. Very okay. When you drive, huh?
Just a question. It's just a question. If the superior, my boss, wants to torture me by psychology, like mentally, then is it on what?
All right. Okay, there are a few laws which are relevant here. Okay, one is you can file in under what we call grievance against your boss. Okay, that's under grievance, meaning you grievance is under internal. Okay, internal procedure in your company. Secondly, you can claim for what you call constructive dismissal. Okay, constructive dismissal because the superior is causing you to make your working environment so toxic that you cannot work in that environment. So you need to leave. It somehow the superior is pushing you because they can't fire you. So they make that environment so toxic that you, all right, you give up and then you just go. So, but then that is under the employment law, what we call constructive dismissal. Okay. The third law, which is more relevant, which
so
is here.
Pardon
me?
That meaning to say it's not
called
under
direct. I come into that. The law of thought. Yeah, law of thought. I'm coming to that. Okay. Now on the perspective of the law of thought. Now, remember just now when we talk about Donahue Stevenson, right? That Mrs. Donahue suffers this nervous shock when she saw the decomposed nail in the ginger beer opaque glasses, right? She suffered nervous shocks. But nervous shock is an emotions, right? So if you can prove that you suffer from a stress, what you call this your emotion was so affected that it changes you. Okay, you're damaged. Okay, you're damaged. Your emotion so damaged because of the of your superior. Okay, of your superior because you've been mentally tortured every day. Okay, in your working environment. So if you can prove that, so your damage is your emotion and your mental damage. Okay, meaning you become so nervous. Okay, you're every time, even when you see your boss's car, for example, at the parking lot, you somehow feel very stressful. Okay, the sight of his car make you stressful. Okay, meaning that one is totally mental emotional damage. All right, if you can get a psychologist certify that condition, okay, you can claim from your superior under negligence. But usually people will go for labor court.
Okay. Because they don't want to take like measurement thing upon like we are damaging in writing. Once we are declared that we have a damaging health of mentally, it affects as well.
Mm-hmm.
Could you have like any other law or shows, any some other section other than showing a proof by the doctor, other than doctor?
Yeah, as I said just now, okay.
Because once we are
law of negligence, okay, which is you need to prove mental and emotion damage and all that, you can go by way of labor law, which is you can claim for constructive dismissal, okay, because your superior is creating is such a toxic environment and it tries to piss you out. So that is constructive dismissal. Okay, it's putting a lot of pressure to you, so for you to just give up and leave. All right, that's what we call constructive dismissal under the labor law. All right. Okay, did I answer your question, Nurul Ain? Nurul Ain, you good? Cool. All right. If you wanted to ask further about that condition, then we can, we can talk. Right. Outside this session, okay. If you wanted to discuss this matter. All right. Now, defenses. Okay, defenses. Now, there are two main defenses to a claim in negligence. Okay. One is contributory negligence. Okay, claimant is, or the plaintiff is partly responsible for his own injury. Mm-hmm. For example, let's say a car accident. A knocks B. Okay, A knocks B from behind. A car, a vehicle collision between two vehicles. Right, A and B, A knocks B from behind. And B suffered, let's say, because of that accident, he suffered, let's say, neck injury and all injuries. Okay, and all other injuries because of the accident. Okay, because of the accident. But the fact shows that B, at that point of time, doesn't wear a seatbelt. Okay, doesn't put on his or her seatbelt. Now, yes, there is a fact. It is a fact that A knocks B from behind. Yes, it is a fact that B suffered because of the accident. B suffered some injuries. It is a fact. But it is also a fact that B doesn't wear a seat belt at the point of time. So why is this significant? The seat belt. Why? What is the purpose of the seat belt?
Because B doesn't maintain the law, driving law.
Okay, law is one thing. Secondly, what is the purpose of seat belt?
So that the impact of accident
happen, that it minimizes you from damage, injury, correct? You will suffer injury. Okay, let's say you are involved in an accident, you're wearing a seatbelt, definitely you're going to suffer injury, right? But the injury will be minimizes, correct? You minimize the risk of your injury. Correct or not?
Yes.
So if you during an accident, you did not wear a seatbelt and you suffer injuries, multiple injuries. Okay, now, this is what we call contributory negligence. Yes, you suffer injuries, but your injury will not be that severe if you had put on your seatbelt. So in this case, this circumstances, during assessment of damages, okay, during the assessment of damages that the defendant need to pay the victim or B, the court need to take this into account, okay, because the court say that B is not 100% liable or 100% contribute to B injury, okay. B, let's say for example, B is asking for 100% of the injury. The court may say that A contribute only say like 70% of the injury suffered by B. So the court may knock off another 30%. Meaning to say, let's say B asking for 100,000. The court may say that, okay, since B, you also contribute 30% to your injury, so out of 100%, you only entitled for 70,000. Okay? Because the court already knock off that 30% from B. Because B contributing to his own injury. Alright, that's the meaning of contributory negligence. Now, second one. The defense, voluntary non-fit injuria. Okay, voluntary non-fit injuria. So what is this voluntary non-fit injuria? It's a Latin word. Okay, who would want to guess from the word voluntary non-fit injuria? I think all of you can guess. Right? What's the meaning of voluntary non-fit injuria? Voluntary is in English voluntary, non-fit lah, injury. You voluntarily injure yourself, right? Okay, how does it happen? Okay, let's say you saw an abandoned house. Or abandoned building. Okay, in front of the building, of that abandoned building, there is a sign saying that danger, do not enter. Okay, abandoned site. enter at your own risk. It's prominently stated in front of the building. Okay? But you go in anyway. I do not know why you enter. Maybe you wanted to film all this all those ghosts, you know that. You wanted to film all that, all those things. So you go in.
Paranormal?
Paranormal. Thank you. Yeah. Paranormal incident, you know that. So you wanted to film paranormal. You wanted to film for your YouTube channel, for example, paranormal things inside the abandoned. But in front of the building, clearly shows that do not enter abandoned building. Enter at your own risk. Okay. Then suddenly when you enter, and something fall down from the ceiling, it hits you. And it hits you on the at your back, for example, and you suffer injury. So now you cannot claim, or you cannot take a legal action against the owner of the building for negligence. Why? Because you enter at your own risk. There is a proper signage showing that do not enter. Okay, do not enter. So you enter anyway, so you suffer damage, you suffer injury because of your action, then you're contributing, or you're voluntarily causing injury to yourself. But it's a different issue. Okay, different issue is, for example, you're walking at the roadside, right? At the pedestrian area, okay, next to the roadside. And then, you know, in Malaysia, at the roadside, there's a lot of manhole.
Yes.
Yep, manhole. Okay, now. Before that. Why manhole is round, not square?
It's a good question, actually.
Okay, I ask you a question after this, huh? That's a very tricky question. Why they created manhole round, not square? Okay, in Malaysia, right, there's a lot of manhole, right? Tenaga Nasional lah, water lah, telecom lah, and all that. Okay. So when they do some work, okay, they open the top of the manhole. They open it, all right? They did not put any sign, okay, warning, okay, construction at work, men at work, you know that. Beware. Okay, there's no sign whatsoever. You walk. Suddenly, you did not realize there's a hole in front of you. Then you fell down. You suffer injury. That is negligence on the part of the contractor. But if you have all those signage and all that, then you go in. You voluntarily go walk at that area, then you fell down, then there's no liability on the part of the contractor.
Doctor, is that one kind of cigarette packet, like the example signage before?
Yeah, the signage. Yeah. That's a valid argument. Okay, that's a valid argument. That's why you see that when you enter a building, you see the cleaner, when they mop, they clean the bit, right? Warning slippery, man at work. Okay, maintenance is going on right now, okay, in the process. So it's a sign for you to be careful. Okay, so if you slip, you fell down, you injure yourself, then there's no liability on the part of the building owner or the maintenance company, for example. Okay, and you are right. If that analogy can be used for the signage in the cigarette packet, you're right. But the argument is the nicotine cause people to be addictive. All right, so there's this cigarette cases have not been tried in Malaysia. They have not been tried in Malaysia because we are not litigious society. Okay, we are not litigious society. We have not tried that in court. Okay, I would love to see anyone try that in Malaysia and see what happened. Okay, I would love to see someone suing the illegal factory for the pollution they cause, the pollution that they discharge in our rivers. I would love to see people suing, okay, suing the contractors or suing the illegal factory for that, for damages, for negligence. Or, okay, this is something, this is only for discussion, eh? I would love to see people suing the government or the local government for failing to take action against those illegal factories. That's negligence. Okay, you know that there's a lot of illegal factories over there near the river, but you fail to take action against them. That's negligence. That's pure negligence. All right, but this is within the four wall of this lectures. Okay, it's something that you may think that it is possible. Right. Right. Now, I think it's an azan. Okay, can we stop for a while for the azan? Okay, can we proceed? Can we proceed? Right? Okay, now. Now, we come to the something which is relevant to you, okay, as professional. Okay, I would guess, okay, I would assume, I'm confident that all of you are professional here, okay? You are professional in your line of job and all that. Okay, most of the time, okay, most of the time when we do our job, we are at risk. Okay, we are at risk of causing damage to our client. Okay, causing damage to our customers. Okay, for example, like when you give professional advice, okay, and you give misstatement, okay, misstatement, and when your client relying on your advice, relying on your expertise, and yet they suffer losses. For example, like a fund manager, for example, okay, when the customer relying on the expertise of the fund manager, okay, to do investment for them, but then suddenly, let's say the fund manager make a mistake, and it causes losses to the customers, to the client, okay, whether the customer can sue, can take legal action against the fund manager. Okay, we look at the case of Hadley Burn and Company Limited against Heller and Partners Limited, 1964. Okay, what happened in this case was the appellant by the name of Hadley Burn, they were an advertising agent. Okay, but then there is their client. Okay, their client wanted to place an ads. So this Hadley Burn is a advertising company. Okay, so there's one client approached them to do some advertising company for them, advertising work for them. Okay, then of course when they do work for the client, they need some payment. Okay, they need some payment, but the client says that, okay, can you give me some credit? Okay, meaning to say, work first on this matter, we're going to pay you later. Of course, when you wanted to give credit to your client, you wanted to know whether your client is in a good financial situation, meaning they have money to pay, all right? Then if you're confident that they have money to pay, then you give them credit. Okay, meaning you do the work first, then you pay later. Okay, the client pay later. Why? Because you know eventually the customer has the ability to pay you. They are in a good financial health. So how do they know that this client is a credit worthy? Okay, credit worthy. Worthy to give credit. So they ask the bank. Okay, they ask the bank about the credit worthiness of the client. But the bank says that yeah, your client is that they are very good. Okay, that they are financial.
But doctor, in that case, can we make a contract? Like, I will do your job, and after that, you will give back money.
Yes, we can. No problem. Okay, no problem. I'm sure that there's a contract here that they will do the job first, then they're going to pay later. But to come to that decision, to give that credit, they need to know whether the client is in a good financial situation. So they ask the bank. Because let's say this customer has an account with the bank, right? So the bank would know how much money in the account. So the bank, in this case, they told Hadley Burn that, cool, this client of yours is in a very good financial situation. The account is very good.
Doctor, without my permission, my banker will give the information about me to anyone?
They don't give you, if they do not have permission, they won't give a specific, meaning, let's say, Sharin in Maybank has say $1 million, for example. No, they won't say that. They just say that Shireen is in a good financial situation. That's it. Okay, so the bank here in this case say that, yeah, the client is okay. All right, but this is wrong. Okay, basically the client is not okay financially. So the Halliburton did the job for this client, and when they wanted to ask for the money, they asked for the payment, the client went into liquidation. So they can't, meaning went bankrupt. So the client bankrupt. Then the client unable to pay Halliburton. So now, Halliburton cannot sue the client because the client already bankrupt. So the next best thing is to sue the bank for damages. Okay, for negligent misstatement, meaning to give wrong statement. Okay, being negligence. Okay, being negligence in giving statement. So in court, okay, next slide. The court said that the bank disclaimer was adequate. Exclude, yeah, pardon me.
Doctor, how many percent chance to get money from the bank if the client became bankrupt?
Yes. Okay, yeah. Okay, we come to that. Yeah, it's a policy issue. Yeah, based on the surface. Okay, based on the surface, it looks like the bank giving a wrong information. So the bank is what? The bank is negligence, right? So the court says that the bank disclaimer, okay, there's a disclaimer that come together with the statement. So the bank says that statement is adequate to exclude the assumption by them of legal duty of care. Mm-hmm. However, in the absence of disclaimer, the circumstances would have give rise to a duty of care in spite of the absence of a contractual or fiduciary relationship. Now, what we learned from this case was, if you are a bank and you wanted to give a credit testimony on behalf of your client, one of your those who have put the money with your bank, yes, you can, but you need to put a disclaimer. Okay, you put a disclaimer that you will not be liable for any losses suffered from those who rely on this information. Okay, you need to put a disclaimer. If there is no disclaimer, then you are liable. Okay, so the effect is there will be a liability for giving negligent statement causing economic loss. Meaning to say, if you wanted to protect yourself, put a disclaimer that you will not be liable for any injury caused by your statement. Anyone relying on your statement, you will not be liable. If there's no disclaimer, then you are liable. Okay, so the court says that before you can prove, okay, you can prove that the bank is liable, one, you need to prove that there is no disclaimer. Secondly, there must be special relationship between the parties. There must be special relationship between Halliburton and the bank. Yeah, all right. Then the bank must know that the other party will rely on your statement and report. Okay, so that is the case in Hadley and Burn. Okay, if you look at another case, okay, Caparo Industry Private Limited Company against Stickman. In this case, it involved auditors. Okay, it involved auditors. In this case, C, a shareholder in F Private Limited Company, is in this company. So C wanted to bought more shares in the company. Right. Maybe he is a minority shareholders, so he wanted to increase his share in the company. But then before he wanted to increase his share, he wanted to know whether this company is financially good, is making money, making profit. So he wanted to increase his share, increase his investment. So he rely his decision based on the audited accounts. This audited account is prepared by the company auditor. Okay, so based on the audited account, he made a bid, a takeover bid. He increased his share in the company. However, after he bought a majority stake in the company going bankrupt. All right. It seems that the audited report is incorrect. Okay, is incorrect. So they sue. Okay, they sue the auditors. The court again. Okay, court again says there are three criteria that you need to fulfill before you can claim damages from the auditors. One, the standard test of foreseeability applied. Okay, the damage must be foreseeable. Okay, the damage must be foreseeable. Secondly, at next slide, the concept of proximity limits. Okay, the concept of proximity limits the duty to circumstances where the statement would be communicated to the claimant either as individual or a member of an identifiable group. What it's trying to say here is, before the shareholder wanted to rely on the audited account or audited report, okay, that shareholder must tell that auditor that, hey, look, I'm increasing my stake in this company. So I'm relying on your report to make my decision. Okay. Then if the auditor give the audited account, audited report based on that purpose, then the auditor is liable. But if the auditor just make a general report, he doesn't know who's going to use the report, okay, then the shareholder in this case cannot claim against the auditor. All right. And then number three, okay, Chari, this is what we call public policy. Okay, public policy says that when the court applied this criteria to cover a case, they found that auditors of the company owe no duty of care to the public at large who rely on accounts when purchasing shares in the company, nor was any duty owed to the individual shareholders who purchase additional shares. Now, this the third one comes on the public policy reason. Okay, the same as Hadley and Byrne just now. When you say that if we allow this kind of claim against the bank, then everyone going to claim from the bank. The same with the Kaparo industry. If we allow everyone claim against the auditor, then there will be what you call this opening the floodgates. Everyone going to claim from the auditors for their damages suffered in the stock market, for example. But do you see that this decision quite disturbing? Anyone see that this decision is quite disturbing, this public policy decision? Anyone find it disturbing? Shazana, Ilyas Shazana? What do you reckon, Ilyas Shazana? Ilyas Shazana, what do you reckon? What's your opinion, Ilyas Shazana? Ilya? I can't hear you, Ilya. You need to speak up. Yeah, Ilya. Okay. Yeah. I see you. Yeah. What do you reckon?
Sorry. So what is the question again?
The question is, when the court in Hadley and Byrne and also Kaparo and Dickman says that they can't put the liability on these banks and also the auditors because of the public policy. Do you find it disturbing or do you find it okay? All this public policy, safeguarding auditors, safeguarding the banks against negligence. Ilya, I can't hear you. You need to speak up.
I already
talked. Yes. You need to change your speaker. Hey, I'm not talking about other speaker. I'm talking about your laptop speaker. I'm not talking about the speaker of the whatever speaker. Muhammad Ridwan, what do you reckon, Muhammad Ridwan?
I don't have any ideas, sir. So.
All right, no idea.
Maybe it could lead to manipulation.
Sorry?
Maybe it could lead to manipulation
of the banks and the auditors.
Because if the auditor can release they don't owe any duty of care. Maybe any information they release, they can choose what information to release.
Yep.
Possibility.
Yep. You're right. If you guys remember the case of Enron. In America, Enron in America, it involved auditors from Arthur Andersen. You guys remember that case?
Okay.
Because the one who what Enron did was they inflated their profit. They say that they are making profit, but in reality they are not. But who conspired with Enron of inflating this profit is Arthur Andersen, an auditing firm.
Mm.
Right, auditing firm. So this Arthur Andersen, they conspired with Enron to show that the company is making profit, inflated their profit by not giving a true picture of the company's financial health. And it causes losses to the company, causes losses to the investors, losses to so many people, right? To the employee. Why? Because in the US, the employee, they do not have like KWSP or the EPF and all that. They're relying on the shares of the company. After they retire, at least they have shares of the company so they can live with the dividend, or they can just share sell the shares to get some profit.
Mm-hmm.
So at the end of the day, the shares of Enron come up to zero. So all the employee, not only they lost the job, they lost their retirement security as well. So all because of Enron conspire with Arthur Andersen in inflating their profit. So well, Enron did going to bust. They went into liquidation. Arthur Andersen, nobody. I think Arthur Andersen. No, there's no action against Arthur Andersen at the point of time. But they need to close shop. Okay, they need to close because nobody now wanted to engage Enron to do their auditing work anymore. Because there's no credibility. Okay, there's no credibility towards Arthur Andersen anymore. Because let's say any company wanted to engage Arthur Andersen in the future to do auditing for their company, and whenever Arthur Andersen give a report, nobody going to believe that report. Because the integrity is not there anymore. Right? So they go bust. Okay, they go bust. Enron go bust, Arthur Andersen go bust, you know that. But it goes back to our discussion just now. All right. Although the bank or the auditor may be protected by the court or by the law, okay, for the public policy, but the invisible hand of the market, okay, the invisible hand of the market may punish the bank or the auditor for giving false statement, okay, especially now we are learned not to be forgiving anymore. Okay, if you look at the Twitter, we always try to find someone to blame. Right? Anything, any problem in this world can be solved by blaming someone else. Right? So we are learned not to be forgiving. Okay, we lose that. We lose that humility and humanity. I don't know what. Okay, I don't know. Okay, that's for another discussion for another day. Okay, discussion for another day. All right, any other question? We come to the end of the lecture. Any question about the law of thoughts, the law of negligence, duty of care? Any question?
It's quite transparent.
Very transparent, yeah? All right, yeah. Quite straightforward also. Okay, now, for this subject, for this topic, what you need to do is, or what you need to remember, just this. To prove, okay, someone breach or to take legal actions against someone for a law of, under the law of negligence, first you need to prove, one, that person owes you a duty of care. Secondly, you need to prove that that person breached that duty of care. So first you need to establish the duty. Secondly, you need to establish that he or she had breached that duty. Thirdly, you need to prove that you suffer damage because of the breach. Okay. And fourthly, you need to prove that the damage is not too remote. It must be foreseeable. You need to prove all four. Okay. And as a defendant, okay, as a defendant, what are your defenses? There are two. One is contributory negligence, meaning the plaintiff contribute to his or her own injury. Secondly, that the plaintiff is voluntary causing harm to himself, voluntary non-fit injuria. Those who voluntary causing hurt to himself doesn't fit for any damages, for any compensation. All right. Okay. Cool. Any question before I end the session? Okay. So next week we're going to talk about law, company law. Okay, company law. So you just get hold of a copy of Companies Act 2016. Okay, you can. You don't have to buy. You just download from the internet. Okay, save money.
16.
Save money. All right. Now I think final exam also most probably, you know, most probably, I'm not sure. Okay, something might happen in between. So your final exam may be through VLE, maybe through online. So it's good that all your acts like Companies Act 2016, your Contract Act 1950, maybe you wanted to keep it in digital format. Okay, you don't have to buy the physical one. You just keep it in your tablet, in your iPad. So when you wanted to answer the question, you just refer to your iPad or your tablet, something like that.
Okay.
All right, so next week we're going to talk about company law, yeah? So get the Companies Act 2016.
Okay, Doctor.
Thank you.
Stay safe, yeah. Stay safe. CMCO.
All right.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right. I'll see you next week.
Thank you.
Okay. Bye.